Okay, I'll do it on this side. Because we're going to have to erase some of it. And let's say I'm going like so. And goes. Okay. Now, watch my brush. When I'm going to go onto the brush, I'm just going to go once, right? So I'm going to take that brush and I'm going to go once. And that's pretty much done. And then I'm going to deselect it. And then because it's on another layer, I'm going to go back in now a little closer. And I am going to, there's two ways we can do this. We can take the eraser tool and turn the opacity down and soften up our lines. Like so, as we're drawing and sketching. Or we can take the blur tool and blur them back in. But be careful, because you want some of the hard lines. Look at, do you see my strength is at 11%? Yes. Never use it at 100 because it'll just blur everything out. So on one side of the line, I want to soften it. The other side, I want to keep hard.
I see.
To create that feeling. And then when you go to draw over top, you can now go back with the pencil and inside these lines that we've created, we can start drawing and sketching so that it feels like the photographed version. See how when I do the drawing and the sketching, I'm not worried about going over lines. Actually, I don't really try and get things perfect. Perfect's the wrong way to think about it. Try and make it as organic and as fluid as you can so that it looks painterly and real. And your personality will start to show in the drawing. And as you zoom back, you see how it's slowly on my drawing here, it's starting to feel more like the coat. Well, excuse me. If I merge that down, take the opacity down, and then go over top of it again with the drawing side, and I'm looking at your coat, and I'm going to say, okay.
Yeah, I can kind of see it coming to form over time.
Yeah, because what you're actually doing is you're painting. You're not doing it the other way. You're actually... you're creating a painting, which is what you should be doing, right? And Photoshop...
You have no camera.
Pardon?
Oh, sorry, my parents were just knocking my door.
What's oh, up? Okay.
My bad. You were saying?
Yeah, and what you're going to end up with is something that feels like you drew it and not cut and pasted it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the closest rendition to that I've ever done, so I'm having a lot of fun doing this.
Yeah, and it's almost, it's like so many new doors have opened up for you tonight that it's cool. And it's cool watching you realize how much fun digital can be when you actually start using it as a painting tool. And not a photo manip tool.
Yeah.
Yeah, and basically, that's really what that lasso tool, well, what I feel the lasso tool was actually created for. least that's
doing more studies with this for sure, especially with the lasso tool in that direction, just because I could see myself playing with it in so many different ways.
Because you have that strong artistic background, you can now see all the possibilities and uses that the little tiny techniques that I showed you and opened up the doors for it.
Yeah.
How easy it's all going to be. See how mine still looks like a drawing, but as I work it up and work it up, it's starting to feel like that material.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want, what we can do is we can, you have to work on your contrast. You have to go darker. You see how the black, is in the jacket? Mm-hmm. You have to go that dark too. And it will feel more like that jacket. But if you want to pull up, say, a different material, we can work on something else.
Yeah. I might have to leave in 15 minutes-ish just because...
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. Want to take me out for like a walk.
Yeah, you guys know you always have access to me. So if you guys want something, just let me know. Like Wilfred did on, you know.
Yeah. I'm just pulling up random stuff that I might be interested in.
Yeah.
Not those.
One thing, Alan, you should know is that you're making every SA student's dream come true tonight.
That's awesome. Because
the one thing I always thought lacked in essay was like a lack of painting. I've been really craving for material like this.
We don't know how to paint. We don't. And then we're not taught.
So having something like this even available to us has been
I'm always available to you guys. You guys are like the best essay group I've ever seen. And you guys make me feel so much like part of your family that, I'll bend over backwards for you guys. There's fur.
Aww. Yeah, I'll bring up the fur.
Yeah. You guys are sweet. And Liam, did you get to see those cats? Those hairless cats? They were adorable, weren't they? Yeah. Okay, so we now have that material that's fur. And it's basically hair. So what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to do the same thing because we're now painting again. We're going to find a mid-tone. So find the mid-tone in that fur and then draw its basic shape.
Yeah, I just want to open it up in Photoshop so I have a...
Yeah, so it's there beside you.
Yeah, I just can't seem to pull it in. Maybe it's not a supported format or something. Yeah, it's not a supported format. Awesome.
It's time for screenshots.
Yeah. Let me just open it and then take a screenshot of it and open that. There we go. Save it. Get rid of it. Desktop. Perfect. There we go. Just gonna... Yeah, right there. And then I'll just hide some layers.
Yeah. Or you can like put it on a different piece of paper and it'll be easier for you.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
I'll just put it here.
Because what we're doing is just, we're just doing some study.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be doing the same sort of thing. We are going to draw its basic shape first. And we're going to do that in the mid-tone. Because value is so important. And it doesn't, and to be honest, it really doesn't matter what color you make that fur. If you get the shape language right, it will always look like fur. Because fur can be pink, right? Dyed pink. So just draw that, and then we are going to put a layer on top for the next section. That's very, very soft fur. So that indicates that that fur is short.
Mm-hmm.
It's not long fur. So when we go to do our strokes, we're going to go like this. And we are going to continue those strokes in that direction going up. So it's going to go around like this, and every one of them is going to be pointing towards that X as we're doing it.
Yeah.
And we're going to make them quick and short and keep building them up. But notice also that I didn't go too dark with the shape. So get your shape language right in the shape that you want to build it.
Mm-hmm.
And then start doing what I'm doing. We're going to create a fur texture. And I am going to continuously, slowly keep going towards that X.
I see. So you're building it up with really, really small strokes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I'm doing it super, super, super fast. And I'm not thinking that I'm going to spend a lot of time on each one of these crazy strokes because, you know, we don't want to be here for like months and months and months.
Yeah. Also, sorry to cut it short, but it does seem like they're coming for me, so I'm probably going to have to dip in file.
No problem.
Yeah, I really appreciate it though, Alan, because this has been so, so helpful for me.
So I'm going to do this really quick so we can go over it again sometime.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to drop the, I'm going to make the value darker, and then I'm going to start spacing out my strokes and making them smaller.
Mm-hmm.
In the areas that are like looking at the photograph, you can see how there are certain areas that follow the form and they start doing this sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But every one of these strokes is going to be nice and small, and there's going to be some variation in it. And then once I get this done and it feels right, I'm going to go to those highlights and I'm going to go up. And then I'm going to start going back and start adding in highlights where the fur is. See that?
Yeah.
Right. And then it starts to come out, and it will, if you do this way, it will definitely feel like fur.
Mm-hmm.
See how it's, yeah, I'm doing this really, really quick because I know you got to go. See how it's starting to.
Yeah, the highlights are starting to pop out, and it's starting to feel like it's like layered on top of one another.
Yeah, because we're using that pencil that is, the opacity is turned down, you can see the strokes underneath the other strokes. And it starts to create the illusion that it's fur. Now you see the edge, and how it's dark, because that's the shadow. You can start drawing that in the same way.
And, oh, I see. And they'll make it pop out even more.
Yeah. And then you can come back in with a little bit of line work. Like that. And now you have the zipper that's over there. And then you've now created the illusion that it's all fur.
Mm.
Yeah. But you gotta keep doing this layer after layer after layer until it builds up.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you could do it very graphically, but it won't look like fur. But if you continue doing this, the more you do it and the more you keep building it up, the more it's going to look like a photo.
Yeah. I'll have to do some studies like later on tonight and over the next week and come back to you.
Yeah, that'll be fun. I would love to see them. Yeah.
Yeah, but just as like a funny tidbit, this is the first time I try to draw that jacket compared to, you know, as it is now.
Now
it still could use a lot of work, obviously, but it's so much better than this.
Yeah. The difference is that in the one that you first did, you weren't painting.
Yeah.
You weren't drawing it. It was all graphic to you. But now that you look at the other one, you're painting it now, and you're building it up as if it was an actual painting. So that's the difference. It's not that the skill level has changed, it's your knowledge of how the paint works has changed. But hopefully that has opened so many doors for you.
100%.
Yeah, and go enjoy your time with your friends.
Yeah, I appreciate it, Alan.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, I'll see you guys all later. And thank you again for the lesson. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
What the? Could not save because the... And then it just cuts off?
That's Photoshop for you. Oh, and next time we get together, guys, we'll do Clip Studio.
Oh, I have no space on my C drive.
Ouch. Ouch. You need to clean up. Yeah. So how many of you guys actually own Clip Studio?
I just bought a key for it. So I just recently started to own it.
Does anybody else own Clip Studio?
I've been depending on Clip Studio for the past semester.
Okay. If you guys want, I can show you how to start setting up your brushes in Clip Studio.
I can, yeah, that would be great. Okay. I would assume it wouldn't be that different compared to Adobe. Would it?